So hi everyone, welcome to this first not ordinary seminar of the year. Actually, I'm the new person in charge of the not ordinary seminar. My name is Mizan, so if you want to organize a conference, you can come and see me and we will set up something. So we will start the conference now with Lê. He will talk about different topics related to mathematics of the 20th century. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mizan, for this introduction and for the organization. Hello, everybody. It's the first time I'm giving a talk of popular mathematics, and I'm very excited. Hope you guys are too. It's being recorded, so and I'm going to upload the video on YouTube afterwards. So if you have questions to ask, make sure that they're good questions, okay? so the title of this talk is A Trek Through 20th Century Mathematics. And the reason why I use the word trek is because I'm going to be using a lot of metaphor of traveling and trekking all along. So I'm kind of your guide here, and I'm taking you in a journey through a new world. Just think of this like that. Now, when I start traveling, the first thing I usually do is look at a map. So let's look at a map of the planet we're going to be exploring today. So this is the map of the planet. There are different continents. Each continent is sort of an area of mathematics, so there are different regions for us to go around. What we're going to do is to take a plane to fly from one region to another. We'll have a short stops at each location, take a few pictures, do a little hiking, and then fly to the next destination. The first destination we're going, this looks like the Earth, but I don't mean any geopolitical implications, so don't confuse it with Earth. If you're disturbed, you can think of this as a proof of my ignorance of geography. Okay, so we're going to start here in Montreal, but more precisely just right here in the GERAD. So the GERAD is the research lab that's hosting this event. And here at the GERAD, I'm going to say we to talk about the GERAD, even though I'm not the one who made the discoveries. But I'm kind of defending my research lab, so I'm going to say we, even though I'm not included in this we. And here at the GERAD, we work a lot on different prime of optimizations of applications of mathematics, and one of the major fields we're working on is linear programming. So linear programming started during the 1940s, during the Second World War, where more and more problems were studied, and these were decision problems. In fact, any decision problem can be stated more or less as follows, like optimizing some decision with regard to certain constraints. Now, you can write any problems like that. But more often than not, they are very difficult to solve. And now sometimes they have some very nice structure, which we call linear structure. And there's actually a lot of problem which has this very specific linear structure. And whenever a problem has this linear structure, it can be regarded as a very nice mathematical problem, which is basically finding the lowest point of a polyhedron. Okay, and there's a translation that's easy to be done between the kind of real-world problem and the mathematical one. Okay, so to solve the real-world problems, and there are a lot of them which are linear, we need to solve this mathematical problem. Now, how do we find the lowest point of a polyhedron? Now, a great idea is to imagine ourselves living on this polyhedron. So you can think of this polyhedron as a planet, and we're living on it. And so, for instance, we're here. And like, there are different cities on this polyhedron, which are the extreme points, the summits of the polyhedron. And like, we can move from cities to cities, but we don't want to get around in the countryside because the countryside here is very dangerous. You can imagine that there are tigers. Or, I don't know. Don't go there. We want to stay in the cities. Okay. Now we want to reach the cities at the lowest. So it's kind of like the South Pole. So we want to get to the South Pole. Now, how do I get to the South Pole? In real life, I usually use Google Map, okay? But the problem here is that this planet can be n-dimensional, so it can be a very complicated planet. it's very hard to draw a map of an n-dimensional planet. So we cannot do that. Now the next best thing would be a compass. And actually in the 1940s, the great idea by George Danzig, among others, was to imagine a compass for this specific planet. So he actually provided us with a compass, which would tell us which is the direction towards the South Pole. So for instance, if we add this city here, we can check all the paths that go out of this city. So the paths of the edges of this polyhedron. And we can see if the path is to the south or not. So for instance, here you have three paths that go out of this city. So we can take any of them to go to the south, towards the south. So for instance, let's assume that I take this one, I go there. Here there are still two paths going out of this city. Look at the compass, they both go south. So you can take any of them, say take this one. Now you have one to the south, the other to the north. We want to go south, we take this one. And then we eventually reach a point, a city here, from which all paths lead to the north. And whenever you look around you, it's the north, then that means that you are at the South Pole. Okay? So this kind of simple idea is actually one of the greatest ideas of the 20th century, and it has really revolutionized the way we approach real problems, like especially industrial problems, and there are a lot of applications of that. It's called the simplex method, and it's applied, for instance, in electricity markets, in shift scheduling, vehicle routing. Well, there's a lot of applications of that. Okay, so that was like in the 1940s. Here at the GERAD, we're working on improving this problem, this resolution. Because the trouble is, this works all the time, but it can take a lot of time. And the time it takes is kind of the number of times you'll have to look at the compass, so basically the number of cities you'll go through. In this case, we had to go through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cities. So it took kind of a long time. Can we do better? Now, the question of how to do better is something that has been, well, pretty much well answered here at the GERAD by a few of its researchers. So when I say we, I don't mean me, I mean rather these guys. So you have Desrosiers, Soumy, Desaunier, and Gendreau. And they kind of figure out that the reason why it took so many steps to go to the South Pole here is because this polyhedron is kind of complicated. It has this blue face here, which makes it complicated. And they had the idea of making it simpler. How do we make it simpler? Well, you can just get rid of the cities of this blue face here. And you obtain a new planet, which is much simpler. Okay, it's just a prism here. I don't know how you call this surface, but it's much simpler here. Okay, and on this new planet here, it only takes two steps. So you only have to go through three cities to get to the South Pole. Now, there are a few issues I'm not going to dwelling on. You might have removed the actual South Pole, so you need to find ways to actually add it afterwards. I'm not going to get into the details, but what I want you to notice here is that the reason why this idea is a very good idea is basically because you change the connectivity of the cities of the planet. And this notion of connectedness is one of the key notions of the mathematics of the 20th century. And it's studied by another field. So let's move to another place, California, to study graph, to see a little bit of graph theory.